following is an interview with Mrs. Hannah Fisk on the evening of January the 24th, 1983, at her home in Oak Park, Michigan. Donna Miller is the interviewer. Could you tell me something about your life before the war? Could you tell me your name? State your name for me.
Before the war?
Your maiden name.
Was Hanka Monchik. M-O-N-C-Z-Y-K.
Okay, and you were born where?
In Częstochowa, in Poland.
Can you describe your life before the war?
I was a simple little girl. I went to school. As a matter of fact, I only finished my sixth grade when the war broke out. They didn't let no Jews continue with schooling. So all I had is sixth grade.
Can you tell me about your family? How large was your family?
Oh, we had a huge family. I had six brothers and four sisters. My mother passed away. I was 2 years old. I never remember my mother. My father remarried. I had a stepmother. But we were not too bad. Getting by.
What did your father do for a living?
My father had a place where you sell coal for the winter. Mm-hmm. When people come to buy winter and summer. Mm-hmm. And he also was a glass repair. He knew how to repair glass. You know, cars and windows. Mm-hmm. Like I say, I wasn't too rich, but we made a comfortable living.
Mm-hmm. Did your stepmother work also?
No, she never worked. She had her children too. Mm-hmm. Before my father got married, she had from the previous marriage. Mm-hmm. So actually we were only about four in the house, because none of my sisters and brothers wanted to stay with the stepmother, so they all flew the cook. Everybody was gathered around someplace else. I had an aunt in Sosnowiec. I had an aunt in Lodz. One of my sisters was working there, you know. So I was the only one because I was the youngest.
Mm-hmm. Okay. How many aunts and uncles lived in Częstochowa? How many of your family members lived in Częstochowa?
My aunts and uncles?
Yeah.
None of them. No, not that I remember. They were all the way in Poland. One of them in Bohatów, one in Lodz. One was living in Radomsko, you know. None.
Did you see them very often?
Yeah. They used to come to us too, and we used to go there. Every summer, practically, I went to my aunt. She had a bakery. That was my father's brother. And she was rich too. Mm-hmm. And she always supplied all the clothes and everything we needed, because she never had any children. So we were like their adopted children.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Can you tell me about the town itself?
Poland. Where I was living in Częstochowa was the most nicest town, the most cleanest town. We had like beautiful streets, you know, and that was the largest church in whole Poland, called the Black Madonna. And from March till November, they're coming to worship, you know, they're coming like pilgrimage. It was beautiful. It was really the nicest, cleanest city in Poland. And it wasn't every child. We were having fun. I had lots of friends. I belonged to organizations when I was about 12 years old.
What organizations did you
belong? Zionist. I was always a Zionist. I always was proud of my heritage, and I never deny it. Uh-huh. Even in concentration camp, as bad as I had, I always spoke up. Later on, when you interview me, I'm going to tell you an incident.
Okay. What Zionist groups did you belong to? What
Call it the Gordonia. Mm-hmm. You know, kept together, and we had a lot of fun. I didn't know no politics or stuff like that, but we were singing. Saturday we come together, we were playing racquetball and handball, and we had quite a bit of fun until 39.
Were your parents very political? Did they have any?
No, my parents were strictly Orthodox. My father was praying for the people. He was like a rabbi, you know, for Shabbos especially. I was very Orthodox. Saturday I couldn't take a comb. I had to put on a babushka Friday, you know, to make my hair pretty. Nothing. And I had to be home. I am very good in Jewish too, because I went to Cheder till I was 8 years old. And then he sent me to the public school. you know. Okay. But I come from a very Orthodox home. My mother had a shadel. Mm-hmm. They were not fanatic, but they were very known people. When somebody was having difficult marriage or stuff like that, they always come to Abraham. And Abraham always tried to smooth up everything. He was well known in the Częstochowa. In one of the nicest synagogues he was praying. Yom Kippur, he had about 12 boys for Kol Nidre, and our own children too. I was in it too. I remember I was about 6 years old. I put on a yarmulke with a little black suit, you know, and all my brothers, and we were singing with my father, Kol Nidre. Yeah, we were a very close family. Mm-hmm. Yeah, great respect, especially for my father. My father never had to lay a hand on me. Mm-hmm. When he only look at me, I know what's going on.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's not like you have to have respect for you. Mm-hmm. The kids have respect now for your parents. That was different in the old country. You have to respect the parents more.
Mm-hmm. Can you describe a Friday night for me?
Oh my God. With six brothers, it was so nice. My mother put, not my mother, my stepmother put the candles on, and we were singing. My father came home from shul, and I was looking forward to Friday night, to be honest with you. Although Shabbos I couldn't do very much, I had to, we walked. I mean, I had fun, but I had to be back by to say the Baruch HaNafshi, to listen to the Abdullah. You know what's Abdullah. And, but we had a lot of fun. I was raised this way, let's put it this way, you know, we didn't know any other thing. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't go and ride the car, Shabbos, or do anything I couldn't do, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So we really observed, we really were knocked into us, see?
Mm-hmm.
And we mind our own business, we had nice Gentile friends. I was going to school, I was going with Gentiles. And I used to make homework with them and everything, and you never knew it's going to come to something like that, you know. We understand each other, we were having fun with each other, you know, played ball with each other, and we couldn't understand that something like this is possible.
Mm-hmm. Was there ever any anti-Semitism before the war?
Yeah, it started in 19... I remember I was a kid and I went in to buy candies or something, and they already say that the Jews should go to Israel, and Hitler will come, and I don't know where they get it from, but yeah, it started bad, very bad.
Mm-hmm.
When they see a Jew with a beard or a thing, they laugh at him, you know, and they say Hitler will come and cut your beard off and stuff like that. Yeah, that started in beginning 1939,
mm-hmm.
I would say, it started bad.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and they are not hateful people anyway, because mm-hmm. they just like the wind blows, you know.
Mm-hmm.
One day they're friends to you, and the next day you turn around. And believe me, dear, Hitler could never do this. He could never kill 6 million Jews. It wouldn't be for the Polacks.
Mm-hmm.
Because they could smell a Jew from far, far away. That's why I have no pity for them.
Mm-hmm.
I have no desire to go there. I would love to go see my roots.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but when I go there, honey, I'm going to come home in a basket. Either in a casket or in a box.
Mm-hmm.
Because I couldn't be able to stand it. That's all blood.
Mm-hmm.
The whole Poland is blood.
Mm-hmm. Tell me about the neighborhood you lived in. Was it mainly Jewish? Or?
Yes, it was Jewish, but also it was Gentile too. Mm-hmm. I had some Gentile friends. I went to school with them. We had a very nice neighbor across the street. Was very nice all the time. They came Shabbos. They came to you see, by the Orthodox Jews, you don't make Shabbos. You don't put on the light, or you don't put on the stove. So they always came, and especially winter, they made the heat. You know, it's not like here. They had to, you know, put in the heat, put in the coals and wood,
mm-hmm.
make a fire. And then they came to make the light and close the light. And they were really good to us.
Mm-hmm.
But for some reason, they turned against the Jews for
mm-hmm.
in a bad manner.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Can you remember the name of the synagogue that your father belonged to?
It calls the old synagogue.
Okay.
That's the way it called, but it was beautiful. You should see the sculptures, you should see the painting there.
Mm-hmm.
You can't imagine. It's even prettier than the Radio City, and my cousin happened to paint the Radio City.
Mm-hmm.
He lives in New York. but it was prettier. Mm-hmm. But it's unbelievable, those sculptures, but those people could do it. I don't know where they didn't have the tools, they didn't have the ability like now, but something gorgeous. When you came in this shul, you thought you were someplace in like in a museum. Mm-hmm. So beautiful. It was the biggest shul in Częstochowa. Mm-hmm. And they honored my father very much. They Rebbe of Rum, my God, in the street when he was going, they even have respect for him. Mm-hmm. They need a few dollars or something, somebody was... Every Shabbos we used to have a guy that came in, you know, my father brought back from shul to eat with us. Even if we didn't have maybe too much, but it was still enough.
Yeah.
But he knows that guy is hungry, he brought him in and every Shabbos.
Yeah. Can you describe your house for me, what it looked like?
A house, we had one... We had a living room. We have a kitchen. And we have a little bit, a bedroom, and then we had another little like a porch. That's where most of our children were sleeping. I slept with my sister. We didn't have like here, everybody has a bedroom. Mm-hmm. But we were happy.
Uh-huh.
It was not too comfortable, but, you know, we didn't have a bed up in the, we had to go outside.
Mm-hmm.
And then we didn't have a, you know, to like here, everything, the convenience, but he survived. He wasn't going around dirty, believe me. My stepmother happens to be a remarkable woman, a remarkable clean woman.
What were your plans for your own future before the war? Did you have any idea what you wanted to be?
Yeah, to be honest with you, I never thought about it. I never thought about it because, first of all, I wanted to finish school.
Yeah.
And then I wanted to go to gymnasium. Gymnasium is like college here, you know. And like I say, I was a young girl and I didn't even have the thought, no.
Yeah.
I just thought it's this way we were raised, this way we brought up, and this way we were.
Mm-hmm. Was there any theater, any Yiddish theater?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Okay. I used to sing in it, too. I happened to sing in it. There was a lady called Lola Folman, and she came from Warsaw, and she fell in love with me. She wanted to take me, but my father was too Orthodox, and he says to me, what? I'm praying for the people, and I'm going to have a movie star, a daughter? And he hit me. That's about one time I remember when he hit me. But I happen to have, I still sing nice now, but not like, because when I was working in the factory, the cotton, my voice became my vocal cord. From the dust, yeah. But I used to sing beautiful, and she fell in love. I remember like today, I was only about maybe 9 or 10 years old. Mm-hmm. When the Polish Pilsudski died, that was in 19... My God. Look, I don't remember. I was singing for 500 people. We were singing a song in Polish that he's gone, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And my voice... My soprano was so beautiful that I had, all I had is a little violin, and I sing the same thing. 500 people, I was singing in the Luna Theater, that one of the nicest theater in Częstochowa. Yeah, but my father wouldn't let me. He says, I'm praying for the people and you're going to be a movie star? No way. And she's alive. She's alive. She's in Israel. I heard about her, I never saw her, but she's alive.
Mm-hmm.
She's old now, naturally, you know.
Can you tell me how your life changed when the war started, when the Germans invaded?
Well, first of all, my sister, the one I described, who lived in Auschwitz, she got married in 39, July.
Mm-hmm.
And she got married, she was by my brother's in-law. She was there in a, working in a butcher shop. She was a sales lady. And she met my brother-in-law, and she got married. So I came to the wedding. That was, I think it was in July.
Mm-hmm.
She got married in July. And I remained there for the vacation, and in September I was supposed to go back.
Mm-hmm.
But I could never go back, because the war broke up September the 1st, 39. I never see my father again. I went away to the wedding, and he came to the wedding, and he went home. I remained there a few months. My sister said, stay with me, and then I had my sister-in-law. My brother was living there.
And this was what town? What was the name of the city? That
Chorzów.
Okay.
Poland.
Okay.
They call it, that was the Polish-German corridor.
Okay.
They called it Koenig City. And then I could never go back. But my sister got married in 39, and then beginning 40, the kids, she had a twin children.
Mm-hmm.
And then when they sent us out from Auschwitz, and we went away, we came into Sosnowitz, all the Jews. They had to be Judenrein.
Mm-hmm.
No Jews. We came into Sosnowitz before Pesach,
mm-hmm.
Easter, 1940. And I was with my sister. I was living with my sister because they took away already my brother-in-law. They took him to Zwangsarbeitslager. I was living by my sister and also by my sister-in-law. They were living in one room. Excuse me. I was there from April to December. In December, right before Christmas, We got a telegram, my father passed away in Częstochowa. They still made him a burial, at least. He didn't go to Auschwitz, and I'm glad for this. But I don't know where his grave is, because when I came to Poland after the war, and I wanted to put a monument, there was no graves. They took all the graves out and planted potatoes. You should see the potatoes like this growing there.
Can you describe what happened to your father, what you told me about before?
They took him, the German, he was a religious guy with a beard, so they took him to the big church, what I tell you, about the Black Madonnas. They kept him in the basement for 2 weeks, and they kept on pouring water, cold water. He was naked. I mean, that's what my brother told me. He still was dead. After they let him out, he had ammonia. And shortly after that, he died. So we had a telegram, and he was sitting shiver for a week. We got up shiver Friday. Saturday night, for some reason, I haven't slept by my sister. I had a funny feeling because they were already hunting for girls, catching. They're coming at night and taking her from bed, sending to labor camps. So I slept by my sister-in-law. Was living like across the street. They came in 1 o'clock at night. They took me out from bed. It was in 1940, before Christmas in December. I remember when I came to the barracks, there was still the water dripping there. They were new, brand new. The water was still dripping. I have never seen my people anymore.
You were taken alone then, without?
They took me to the lager, and from there I was there about 3 days. My sister-in-law brought me a pair of shoes and a coat. And about 5 days later, they took us on where you put the kettles, the trays, you know. What do you call this? You put the kettles, you know, with the
kettle car.
That's right.
Yeah.
And I came to Gabersdorf, to that concentration, to that labor camp. In the beginning was not too bad. I worked in a spinnerie factory, in a cotton factory. I happened to be very handy, and I knew every machine there, everything. And we didn't have no SS or nobody, you know. Just the Judenrein did.
You
know, she was getting an appel, and how many we were in? 360 girls. And went to work every day, came back. It wasn't too bad. Every second day we get about not exactly a half a pound, but a little less bread, a piece of margarine, sometimes a little jam. Soup wasn't too bad. But in 42, then when it really started getting bad, the SS came in and they took it over. It was really bad. For a while I was working in the kitchen. And I was really good to my girls. I really helped them. When I see a girl was already, you know, down and everything, I didn't let it. I used to sing for them every night. In summer, they opened the window, the barracks were open. I used to say, Hanka, sing something. And I did. And I cheered them up, you know. You happen to have a Jewish. You'd know, I'm not going to name nothing because she's my sister. I'm going to say nothing. She used to be miserable, mean. You hit the girls, terrible. Without mercy, without nothing, for nothing. And I used to cheer them up. I said, girls, it will stop, it will go away and stuff like that. In 1943, we had Gestapo already watching us outside the barracks at night. So for some reason, a guy recognized me, and it says, and he came over to me and he says like that, is your name Monchik? I thought, okay, oh, brother, I am going to Auschwitz. Mm-hmm. He says, don't be afraid, I'm the kind of angst. Can I talk German here too?
Yeah, it would be better if you could.
German? He says, don't be afraid, I know you. I says, you know me, how do you know me? He says, I am from Chorzów. Your brothers sewed suits for me. They were tailors. I had four brothers, they were working together. And he recognized me, and he was good to me. And he says to me like that, too bad that I cannot contact this girl here. She will tell you. Mm-hmm. He says to me, listen, I'm going to be here twice a week. When I come, you can go to the grave there and get some potatoes for the girls. And what they did, they had like a little, the soup, the cans, mm-hmm. They put in a can and a little water with a potato. They took it to the factory because the women, the German women, used to warm their lunch. Mm-hmm. So it was cooking there long enough, they could eat potato. Sure enough, it gave me an idea. I had a coat, I took the packets out from the coat, and I went. Mm-hmm. I didn't need them because I had enough to eat, but I took it from my girls. And when I came back, I says, get up, everybody get up and take it, because I'm going to go to Auschwitz for you. Sure enough, one night, he hears the lager here, and that's the SS, the Gestapo, mm-hmm. coming from far away. He runs over to me and he says, go, 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 please, please, they're coming. Somebody's coming from the... The lagerfer was coming. I ran home. Boom, 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 the potatoes, full potatoes in my coat. My luck. I was sleeping upstairs. You know how the bunkers are, down and up. I went in with the potatoes. And I covered myself and... I pretend I'm sleeping. Mm-hmm. And she comes in and she opens the light and she says, damn it, who was grabbing, who was stealing potatoes here? I saw somebody. And she got to go around with that, the Jewish woman. I was more afraid for the Jewish woman than for that. She was really a Jew. She was not as bad. But she had to pretend, after all, she's German. And I said, dear God, if she finds me with those potatoes, tomorrow I'm in Auschwitz. I said, do something, God, do something. Well, 3-4 times she came back, she put the light down. German, the Jewish girl says to her, you know, from Lagerfuhrer, nobody was here. I didn't see nobody, really, mm-hmm. because I was up till now and I didn't, I just went to sleep. She says, myself, I didn't see no light and nothing. She says, I see something running from the ground there. Oh, God was good to me. She went away. The man came in and put a little stone in my window, and I know already. So I got down and I opened the light and I says, go down and take those potatoes, if not, I'm going to get killed because of you. And that girl, what I call you, last week I was in the neighborhood, and there was a woman sitting and she told a story. Uh-huh. She'll never forget those potatoes. So they, everybody got up, grabbed the potatoes from me, put in a little sink thing. So they had what to eat. Mm-hmm. But I almost... That was my life. Mm-hmm. You see, that was not a few times, quite a few times. Mm-hmm. Then he came to me and he says like that, you know, Miss Wonchik, I would like to take you with me to Chorzów. to Cambridge City. My wife is going to put you in a basement and we're going to hide you. That was in beginning 1944. You don't have to stay here. Don't worry. You can trust me.
Mm-hmm.
And I says to him, Otto. Then I called him already Otto. Mm-hmm. He was already closer to me. Listen, whatever going to happen with 350 girls, it's going to happen with 359.
Mm-hmm.
I am staying. I can go away from my sister's here.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not leaving them. Maybe he would hide me.
Mm-hmm.
He was fine, good, like gold. Mm-hmm. Used to bring me bread at that time. Used to bring me a piece of sausage
mm-hmm.
in the packet, you know. I happen to be lucky, you know,
mm-hmm.
just plain lucky, because that was only luck. When you survive Hitler now, you are lucky,
mm-hmm.
plain luck. And I was working in the factory with that, I told you there were prisoners, they became packages from the Red Cross, you know, from England.
Mm-hmm.
He gave me a piece of candy or a piece of chocolate. Once a month we used to go for bread. So I gave the man, the baker, a piece of chocolate and he gave me a bread.
Mm-hmm.
What do I need the chocolate if I have nothing to eat, you know, this way?
Mm-hmm.
You know, God was good to me. Three times I was standing in the hotel and one of the biggest Himmler came to make a selection
mm-hmm.
and he always took out the big one, the strong one.
Mm-hmm.
He didn't want the girls who cannot walk anymore. And two times the director took me out from the line. He says, this girl I want, this girl, the starke, starke
mm-hmm.
means...
Yeah.
He goes over to him and he says, Herr Obersturmbannführer, I am very sorry. He had to address him, you know, he's mm-hmm. a high rank. But this girl, I can't give it to you because she's working on every machine. Mm-hmm. I need her. I don't have another one to replace her. So the next time when he came, he knew already because they called, you know. He came over in the barrack and he says, they called me Annie because mm-hmm. my name was Anne. The
mm-hmm.
German called me Annie. He says, Annie, I would prefer if you sleep in the factory tonight because tomorrow the Sturmbannführer is coming again. Three times he took me out from the line. I was safe. I would have been,
mm-hmm.
he took out the girls and he sent them to Auschwitz.
Mm-hmm.
The Buchenwald, whatever was closer.
Mm-hmm.
That was my incident. Being in there for 5 years. Can you believe it?
Mm-hmm.
To live with a fear like that?
Mm-hmm. What was his name? Do you recall?
The director?
Yes, the man who... Yeah.
5 years I was with him. But he was a nice guy. Like I say, not everybody was bad. Even the Germans, what I work with them, they used to give me a piece of bread, they used to give me hot potatoes,
mm-hmm.
you know, but they hide it. They were afraid too, because
mm-hmm.
if they knew that they give a Jewish girl, it was sabotage.
Mm-hmm.
To give a Jewish girl a piece of bread, that was, she would go to Auschwitz just like I am.
Yeah. What was the type of work that you did? You worked in the kitchen?
No, yeah, I worked in the kitchen for a while,
uh-huh.
yeah, and then I went to the factory. I worked by cotton.
Mm-hmm.
And cotton, they made fabrics.
Uh-huh.
It was very dusty,
uh-huh.
terrible dusty there. But I know every machine.
Uh-huh.
You can imagine when the German gave me double bread, double jam, and double soup.
Yeah.
It was a very heavy. I was 15 years old. I was carrying between 200 and 300 pounds on my, you know, those cotton when you dry
mm-hmm.
they're so, when they're wet.
Mm-hmm.
When they dry, they're nothing, but when they're wet, they're very heavy.
Mm-hmm.
I used to go like that. I got
mm-hmm.
15 years old. But somehow I survived.
Mm-hmm. What were the living conditions like? What were the barracks like? Can you describe?
The barracks were clean. Oh,
uh-huh.
they were clean, honey. We couldn't fool around. The
mm-hmm.
wall, you could eat from the floor, it was all clean.
Mm-hmm.
They came, inspected the lobby, the German SS
mm-hmm.
came in every day, and we had to, every night, the girl has to wash the floor.
Mm-hmm.
It was every, they was
mm-hmm.
like a lineup, you know. This girl this time, ABC.
Mm-hmm.
Just like, was very clean. Even our, we slept on those straw, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But every month they took them out because they were afraid for the box,
mm-hmm.
the bed box.
Mm-hmm.
We have a few of those, one with the smell so terrible. Not lice, what do you call those? Bed bugs,
mm-hmm.
I guess. And a few nights at the beginning until I get used to it, I was sleeping on the table because my face was all red. Mm-hmm. You know, I used to kill him. He used mm-hmm. to go on me. But most of the time, everything was nice and clean. But one accident, I have to tell you, incident. When I came into the concentration camp the first day, my mother, my stepmother never cut my hair. Mm-hmm. I had braces. My braids were thicker as my hand, all the way to here. She took a scissor and cut them off. As soon as I walked over the step, I was so... I don't think if she told me that time I would care.
Mm-hmm.
If she took off my braids.
Mm-hmm.
But thank God we were not like there in Auschwitz, you know, without hair. We had our mm-hmm. hair. Not much. Because we didn't have no soap, nothing. And I worked in the factory. It was very dusty. I came home. Well, I stood by the douche and I took a cold douche.
Mm-hmm.
No hot water. You had one little piece of soap. They call it Riff. They called Rhein Yiddish Fett. That made from children's skin. You hear the volume. We got it once a month, a little piece. So we had to wash our dress. I had mm-hmm. one dress. Sunday I washed the dress. I wear it all week. Every Sunday we had to wash the dress. And every night when I came back, I stood in my cold douche, so my hair came out.
Mm-hmm.
I say, instead of having lice, I'd rather not have hair.
Yeah. Yeah. What were the sanitary facilities like? Bathroom?
It has to be clean, honey.
It was.
Everything was sparkling. Sparkling mm-hmm. clean in the barracks. The barracks were clean,
mm-hmm.
like a whistle. The floor was white like snow.
Mm-hmm.
To wash them on your knees, mm-hmm. your hands and knees.
Mm-hmm.
But you see, first of all, our concentration camp was not this big. We were under 300 girls.
Mm-hmm.
See, and they were a huge amount, like another girl.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like in Auschwitz, I think there were a million people there. See, that was a different story. But we are,
mm-hmm.
1, 2, 3 barracks, that's all.
And it was all women? There were no
all
men?
All women, no men, no.
Okay.
No. But every few weeks, 4 or 5 weeks, he came and he took out more and more girls and more girls. Well, they replaced them with weak ones, with
mm-hmm.
they could hardly walk,
mm-hmm.
you know, like after the war, you know, when the Russians liberated
mm-hmm.
us. He brought chocolates and coffee, and the girls weren't used to eat it, so
mm-hmm.
they had diarrhea. They were falling like flies,
mm-hmm.
falling like flies. I was lucky, because that prisoner that I was working with him, he
mm-hmm.
spoke German. He was a doctor. And he says to me, he was talking to me in German.
Mm-hmm.
I couldn't speak English. He says, don't eat. Honey, don't eat. You know what you eat? Old bread and hot water. And that I was eating this for a week.
Mm-hmm.
Until my stomach got a little bit, because I was always hungry.
Mm-hmm.
I never, you know, another incident I'm going to tell you. I was my father's favorite. I must have slept with my father until I was 8 or 9 years old.
Mm-hmm.
So every night, I used to pray when I go to sleep, even till this day. I can fall asleep. All kind of
mm-hmm.
dreams come, crazy and everything. So even concentration camp, I was praying. And I said, dear God, once I want to feel how to be full,
mm-hmm.
how my stomach is full, that I don't go sleep empty.
Mm-hmm.
Stomach growling all the time, you know. And still, Yom Kippur, I was fasting. In our Lagerführer, the German used to say, you don't eat in daytime, you're not going to eat at night. I'm not going to give you nothing at night, where she made a joke, which she just gave me. I was fasting.
Mm-hmm.
As weak as I was, unless I was longing for that piece of bread, I didn't eat.
Did many people fast?
Yeah. Yeah, most of all the girls fast.
Okay.
Even if they couldn't, but they did.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Was there much religious observance?
No, we couldn't. We couldn't. We're not allowed.
Mm-hmm.
If we were praying, we were just praying by ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
There were not Jewish books or prayers
mm-hmm.
or nothing. All I prayed for my head, what
mm-hmm.
I knew from home.
Mm-hmm.
You know? No, not allowed. We couldn't have nothing. I had a picture from my parents, and they took it away and burned it right away.
Mm-hmm.
Everything. Not a ring, not nothing.
Mm-hmm. Can you tell me what an appel was like? How did the appels, can you describe those?
The star, you mean?
The appel, when you You told me that they had appels every day at the...
Oh, the appels, yeah. And we were staying in appels.
Yeah.
Well, mostly was the Jewish. The Jewish, the Judenrein that was with us, yeah. You know. And she was counting how many girls. Mm-hmm. Well, like I say, we were always the same. We were 360 girls, mm-hmm. So was counting every day, the girls. And then the SS came, you know, mm-hmm. about 3-4 of them, because it was a little mm-hmm. group. And took us to the factory, opened the gate. The gate was always, what do you call it? You know, we were always...
locked in?
Yeah, but yeah. We were with... biased.
Yeah.
Okay. Biased,
yeah.
The, you know.
Yeah.
So they opened the gate and they took us to the factory and then I don't know where they went.
Mm-hmm.
But when it got time, that was 7 in the morning, and 2 o'clock they came back and again they had to stay in line.
Mm-hmm.
They were not afraid. They were counting us. Mm-hmm. We are there and took us back. It was going on for 5 long years.
So you worked about how many hours a day?
Sometimes 10, sometimes 12.
Mm-hmm. Did you have a day off at all? Any?
Saturday we didn't work. Saturday we worked a half a day till
mm-hmm.
12. But then we came home and we have to wash the floor, first of all,
mm-hmm.
you know, to be clean for Sunday, because Sunday was an inspection.
Mm-hmm.
The lager firm came in and she really inspected, really, everything,
mm-hmm.
the beds, everything. And then Sunday we went downstairs, we had like a basement
mm-hmm.
with the boards, you know.
Mm-hmm.
We didn't have no washing machine. To take a little board, yeah, and soak your dress
mm-hmm.
and everything. We were going around naked all Sunday. And then we put it by the heat to dry.
Mm-hmm.
Winter was terrible. Summer was, you know, you put it outside.
Mm-hmm.
It was not too bad, but the winter was terrible. Many times I put down Monday morning and it was so wet. What can I do?
Mm-hmm.
But
mm-hmm.
for some reason, we were strong. I don't remember having a cold for 5 years. I don't remember having a toothache for 5 years.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know why.
Were many people sick there? Or were...
Not unusual, like
mm-hmm.
I say, not unusual.
Mm-hmm.
On this kind of condition, my
mm-hmm.
God, I wouldn't last. Sometimes I sit down with my husband and I say, I can't believe it, it's me, that
mm-hmm.
I am on my own body, that I went through.
Mm-hmm.
It's really indescribable.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever I tell you a quarter.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. It's unbelievable.
What was the food like?
Well, we had, when we weren't, like I say, when labor camp was not too bad.
Mm-hmm.
We weren't full. I was always going around hungry. But when we were in concentration camp, well, bad. They made a spinach soup. And they never washed the spinach. You can have the box and everything running in the plate, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Or they use the, what you would call it, turnips. Most
mm-hmm.
of the time they make a turnip, and the turnip, I think, with a little flour, no fat, no nothing. You know.
Mm-hmm.
It was terrible. And bread, they gave you every third day, they gave you maybe this much. I don't think it was a quarter pound.
Mm-hmm.
No, but I was working heavy, say, by the,
mm-hmm.
like I told you with that day, you have to eat because if not, you wouldn't last 2 days. So they gave me double soup, and they gave me double bread,
mm-hmm.
and double margarine, and sometimes a little jello, a jam, I mean, you know. So it wasn't too bad, you know,
mm-hmm.
I could pass by, and then the prisoner helped me a lot. As a matter of fact, he wanted me to marry him after the camp.
Mm-hmm.
He wanted me to go with him to England.
Mm-hmm.
But I said, let me go home and see if I find somebody first.
Mm-hmm.
I come from a big family, you know.
Mm-hmm.
When I met my husband, he never let me write to him. I have a picture too.
Mm-hmm.
I have a picture of him.
Mm-hmm.
He was good to me.
Mm-hmm.
He was comforting me. Hold it, hold it, a little more, a little more. You see what's happened? They had on the underground. They had those, but you put it down and at night they could hear what's going on with the war.
Mm-hmm.
See, there were engineers there, there were doctors by then, there were brilliant people.
Mm-hmm.
They were older already, everybody was older. But they, from that, the director from the factory was living up there, and they were downstairs, you know?
Mm-hmm.
All the prisoners were living downstairs,
mm-hmm.
they had barracks too. So they put a cable from upstairs, and they had those you call
it? Earphones.
Earphones.
Yeah.
They could hear everything. So whatever pain comes, honey, a little bit more, a little bit more. Germans go kaput. Germans go kaput. You know what's kaput. Yeah. You go. Baby out. A little more. You hold on more. Hold on. Hold on. Don't give up. Mm-hmm. And he gave me a lot of courage. A lot of courage. Mm-hmm. You were really... some days I thought to myself, are we going to survive this? Mm-hmm. Is it possible to survive this?
Mm-hmm. Did you hear anything while you were there about the rest of your family?
No.
About what had happened to them or anything?
It took me away in 1940. And I came back in 1945, and I went looking for family. I already met my husband.
Mm-hmm.
Wasn't married or nothing, mm-hmm. just a boyfriend. I went over there to Poland, to Sosnowiec. I sold the furniture for my sister, where I was with her. And I sold the furniture for my sister-in-law, an old woman laying there. And I asked her in Polish, you know, I speak Polish, mm-hmm. I speak six languages.
Mm-hmm.
And I asked her, I says, is there anybody left here? Can you tell me? My name is Owen. Didn't find nobody. As a matter of fact, twice I fainted on those steps there.
Mm-hmm.
He had to pick me up. He wouldn't let me go anymore.
Mm-hmm.
No, didn't find nobody.
Mm-hmm.
1940, I saw him last time. I saw my father in 1939.
Mm-hmm.
He came to my sister's wedding and I never saw him again.
Did anybody have any idea in 1939 what was going to happen?
No.
To anybody?
No. He didn't dream about it.
Mm-hmm.
Not like that.
Mm-hmm.
A war is a war. You know, mm-hmm. you fight with the people, with your enemies. But what kind of enemies are we? What do I understand from politics? I was 40 years old.
Yeah.
What did I know? Little I know what's happened. Little I know what's going to be.
Mm-hmm.
Mm. Barbarous. You know what's barbarous? That's what they were, the Germans. That's all.
Yeah. Can you describe the train transport for me when you were taken to Gabersdorf?
From Sosnowiec?
Yeah.
Well, we were on the train about 2 nights and 3 days. It was terrible. It was terrible. Sometimes if they were in a good mood, the Germans, the men took us over there. They let us out. And if not, we couldn't do it in the train either. There was no facility. The barracks, you know,
mm-hmm.
right? Like I say, what, 3 days, 3 nights and 2 days you were on the train.
Did you have any food on the train?
They gave us bread.
Mm-hmm.
They gave us bread, dry bread, I remember, and what else? They gave us something else, but that's beyond me.
Mm-hmm.
No cooked food, no, mm-hmm. not for the 3 days while we were there.
Mm-hmm.
No, but you know what's happened? Everybody had something from home. Because when we were in that barracks there, before we went,
yeah.
my sister-in-law came and she brought me some sandwiches and my other sister brought me a little fruit, you
yeah.
know. So we were allowed.
Mm-hmm.
Happily, they didn't took it away, so we had what to eat. But all they gave us is dry bread.
Mm. Was it crowded in the train?
Yeah, it was crowded yeah. because we were going in the same capacity with the animals.
Yeah.
There were cows and sheep and you name it. They were there. And we were the same. It was crowded. It was not a train where you carry people.
Yeah.
Just where you carry animals.
Yeah.
I mean, they even didn't feel comfortable, the Germans alone. You know, they used to be very angry and they say, in the beginning they were not so bad, you know.
Mm-hmm.
They used to say, why couldn't they have a train a little bit where people are going, not with animals? They didn't like
mm-hmm.
it, because animals were stinking, you know.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't care, they made it,
mm-hmm.
whatever they could. And Stoffen, they were even very upset.
You mean the animals were in the cars with
you? Yeah, with us, yeah. Yeah.
Mm. What was the name of the cotton factory? Do you remember the name of the...
Batzel.
Batzel?
Batzel. Spinnerei Fabrik. German.
Uh-huh.
Batzels Spinnerei Fabrike.
Uh-huh.
Fabrik is factory.
Yeah. Yeah.
See, I don't remember what I ate yesterday. I remember the factory. Let's go back 37 years.
Yeah. Was there any medical facilities there?
No way. Mm-hmm. No way. I remember when one time, the German woman was nicer than the Jewish woman. We were more afraid for the Jewish, for the Jewish oldest one than, mm-hmm. than for the German, you know. So if a girl had a really bad headache or something, she used to sneak in an aspirin or I don't think it was aspirin that time, the name was. Mm-hmm. But she wasn't this bad. She used to love my singing.
Mm-hmm.
So someday she had a little room there. It was beautiful, magical, you know. And she called me in when she was in a bad mood. She was a girl yet, you know. Mm-hmm. And she liked it from the factory, the big shots, you know. But he didn't pay attention to her. He has a wife.
Yeah.
So she was sometimes in a bad mood, and she used to call me, and she used to say, call in the hunker. They know already. So I went in, and I says, what is it, honey? What is it? He says, I want you to sing me something in German. She says, I'm so down. I says, why, honey? Why are you down? And I mm-hmm. went over and she kissed me.
Mm-hmm.
And she gave me a piece of cake, Sunday, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And she says, eat here, sweetheart, eat here. Don't go out. Because I don't want the girls to know that I'm giving you.
Mm-hmm.
I used to sit down 2-3 hours with her and sing her German songs. And she loved it.
Mm-hmm.
And she loved it. And she says, whenever you survive, you think that you guys gonna kill me? I says, no. And we didn't. Mm-hmm. We didn't touch it.
Mm-hmm.
When the Russian came in, and first, you know, they go mm-hmm. for the SS. I said, I know a few words in Russian, you know, and I said, don't touch her.
Mm-hmm.
Don't touch her. She was good to us.
Mm-hmm.
And I let her go. I says, you go home wherever you live.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Like I said, I was more afraid for the Jews. You know.
Yeah.
And now she hadn't my sister.
This was after the war? When you were in the factory, can you tell me anything about the guards? Were there any punishments or any...
Well, they were going back and forth day and night. They were let us a minute alone.
Mm-hmm.
When we used to go out to the bathroom,
mm-hmm.
we have to go over and ask them for permission.
Mm-hmm.
And then they go with us, like prisoners,
mm-hmm.
exactly like prisoners.
Mm-hmm.
We met us a minute alone.
Was there ever any resistance that you knew about?
Yes and no. You know, it's very hard to say, but most of the time. No, most mm-hmm. of the time.
Did anyone ever try to escape? Or?
No.
Okay.
No. We couldn't.
Mm-hmm.
Those gates were so tall,
mm-hmm.
you know, and there were those electric wires that
mm-hmm.
you could just do it and you see that. What's the use? Like I say, I could have escaped that guy. He wanted to take me.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I told you that
yes.
before. But I said, what the heck? The woman probably would get mad someday and go out and say to the Gestapo, say, I'm meeting a Jewish girl here.
Mm-hmm.
You never know. The
mm-hmm.
guy is not home. He's in. And as a matter of fact, he only was with us about 3 months, and then they took him they sent him to Russia, to the front. He cried. He came over to say goodbye to me.
Mm-hmm.
And he says, you might survive, but I don't think if I will. I says, you will. You will, Otto. You're a nice guy. You will.
Mm-hmm.
He says, I wish you luck. He says, I wish you. It won't be long. He told me himself. He says, have faith. It won't be long now. We are really down. We are really down.
Mm-hmm.
The German are not going to last very long.
Mm-hmm.
So he gave me a little bit of boost too, you know.
Yeah.
It was nice from a German
sure.
to hear this, you know. He was a nice guy. I don't know whether he survived or not. I couldn't tell
mm-hmm.
you.
Mm-hmm.
And the one thing, I was lucky to people, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Whoever saw me, even by the machine, even the German woman, you know,
mm-hmm.
every day they came. She kind of hugged me, she brought me a piece of bread, and she says, honey, sit down, I'm going to cover you up, and you eat up the piece of bread. Because she was afraid when she
mm-hmm.
see the German going, you know, the Gestapo. She says, throw away the bread, come right back to the machine. And I went to the machine, like nothing. Yeah, it worked.
Uh-huh. What were you making there? Were you making cloth or finished?
No, we were just, what shall I describe it? We had those big like thread.
Yeah.
We put it on the machines and we weave it. Yeah?
Yeah.
And then from the tin can, big one. And we dried this. We had a big oven. We dry it. Mm-hmm. And then somebody else, and we put it to another factory. And then they made a cut on that. Mm-hmm. It was a heavy, heavy, very heavy work. And dirty too. Dusty. That's why my vocal cords got so bad. You know.
Are there any experiences that you haven't told me about that stand out in your mind while you were there?
Well, I regret one thing. When I went for my health, you know, mm-hmm. after the camp, which I'm getting peanuts, I went to a woman doctor, and he kind of almost gave me the finger in my mouth, and he says to me, Mrs. Fisk, you are a very young girl. Think back. I'm going to ask you something. Did the German rape you? And I cried. Mm-hmm. I was in tears. Mm-hmm. And though, mind you, I have 3 children already. Mm-hmm. I have a friend of mine. She collects $400 a month.
Mm-hmm.
Why couldn't I say?
Yeah.
Why couldn't I say? There's nothing to prove.
Mm-hmm.
But I start crying. This is novel. No, doctor, no. Mm-hmm. Don't ask me this.
Mm-hmm.
No, I don't think they, in our barracks, no. Not they have.
Mm-hmm.
No. Well, first of all, the men couldn't come in. They were standing behind the wire. They were never inside. The women were inside with us.
Mm-hmm.
But not the men. They were at night behind the wire.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Walton?
I don't know. You don't tell me the other thing. She's telling you everything.
You want me to warm up?
Okay. Can you tell me about the liberation? Okay.
Well, they were pretty mean. A night before, they already know that they are in the grave, you know, the Germans?
Mm-hmm.
They still put a bomb under our barracks. When the Russian came in, they had those little, they go around with the, what do you call it, manifest?
Metal detectors?
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
And they came in the barracks and they says, Get out! They were screaming like that. Because what's happened? Well, I didn't speak Russian, I speak Polish. So one happened to be a Jew.
Mm-hmm.
And he says, tell them to get out right away because we detect a bomb. Imagine, they already knew
mm-hmm.
that was the last day, 8th of May, when the capitulation was already about them,
mm-hmm.
you know?
Mm-hmm.
They wanted to put us in the thing, but luckily, it didn't explode. They didn't have time to put the device in or something, I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
And the girls went crazy. The Russian came in. We didn't believe it, you know. They came in and they started bringing us stuff, like I say, coffee and everything. And these girls, the stomachs were not used to it. They mm-hmm. couldn't eat, so they had diarrhea. It was terrible. Mm-hmm. They're going around it. The whole hall and everything was full.
Mm-hmm.
I couldn't stay in the barrack. I went to a German woman when I was working with it.
Mm-hmm.
And I slept by her for about a week. But I was taking care of the girls too. In the Russian came and they were terrible. They wanted to sleep with the girls and they could hardly walk.
Mm-hmm.
So I went over to, and luckily I found a Jew.
Mm-hmm.
He was a Lichtschatz, like a lieutenant.
Mm-hmm.
And I told him this and I asked him, are you Amhu? And he said, yeah, Jews, Amhu.
Mm-hmm.
And I said to him, look at what's going on. They're coming in the barracks. They want to lay down with the girls. I mean,
mm-hmm.
the girls are half dead. And then, so he came in and he put in a thing, whoever will come in the Jewish barracks, we kill them.
Mm-hmm.
And they never came. You know, I was brave. I mean, I was a little more,
mm-hmm.
you know, stronger
mm-hmm.
than the other ones, see.
Mm-hmm.
Some of them, they didn't care. They went from the factory to the bed, and from the bed to the factory, they didn't wash, they had lies, they had... Believe me, I have one girlfriend here, and I thought if she's getting married, that is really a miracle.
Hmm.
You probably interview her too, Herman, Mrs. Herman, no? I mean, some of them were really down, really down.
Mm-hmm.
And some of them got crazy. They didn't believe it, that we are liberated. They got up at night, and they could go to the hell, you know, and then...
Mm.
By me too.
Mm-hmm.
I was married already. My husband used to wake me at night. I said, I have to go. I'm going to be tired. I'm going to be late.
Mm-hmm.
To go to the pal. He says, what are you talking about? You're not in the camp anymore. That was going on almost a year.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, you have it for 4 years, 5 years in your system.
Sure.
It's automatically. But then about a week later, a Russian Jew came over and he brought a big, big, I don't know, was it a, it was not a, looked like a train, but it was not.
Mm-hmm.
And all the girls went in and he took us to West Germany. And we came into Waldenburg, mm-hmm. they call it Waldenburg. I came in a day before my birth, no, but a week before my birthday. My birthday is the 5th of June,
mm-hmm.
where I met my minister here. And I took him, and we went from one station to the other, from one train to the other, from one bus to the other, mm-hmm. looking for people. Whenever I came in, whether it was a Jewish community center or any little Jewish thing,
yeah.
I put my name in case somebody's alive, where I am, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And I went back to Waldburg, and we got married, 1945 mm-hmm. in September. I only know him 3 months.
Mm-hmm.
And then I was at the other way. I was having the first wedding. There was me, my rabbi,
mm-hmm.
a Jew come from Russia, and he gave us our chuppah, you know.
Mm-hmm.
There was nobody. And then I got married, and a man recognized me, and he says, I have a brother in Plyvich that's also not far from Sosnowiec. He opened a bakery. That's my brother Jake,
uh-huh.
who's a baker. So I ran after him. I didn't find him, but I left a picture there, and I left where I am, and next day he came for me. And then we find out that we have the German zone, we have a brother, so we went over in 19... What was it? 46?
Mm-hmm.
No. I was liberated in 45.
Mm-hmm.
45, and then I went to... Yeah, must have been 46, beginning.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, beginning. And I find my other brother, and then he was in Germany for
mm-hmm.
to 49.
What happened to your two other brothers, the two brothers who survived? Where did they spend the war?
The one was in Oranienburg,
mm-hmm.
and one was in Theresienstadt. He was not too far from me, now in Czechoslovakia.
Mm-hmm.
Not too far.
Mm-hmm.
And he was going with the march too. Well, he knew I'm there, in Gabersdorf, he would have come in, you know.
Yeah.
They were both. This Irving was from 1940. They took him away in August, yet, mm-hmm. to the Zwangsjahr. He was one of the first,
mm-hmm.
Irving. Jacob was in ghetto, Lodz. And he didn't go, I think he went when the ghetto was uprising, that was in 43. That's when he went to Oranienburg,
mm-hmm.
that was... not far from Treblinka. That was a camp too, a Teuton camp. Yeah. So that's all I came back and I... all Europe I went. There were typhus fever, there were everything. I went from one place to the other and every place where I go gave my name,
mm-hmm.
where I am and what I'm living, you know. But that's all I found, mm-hmm. is two brothers.
You went back to your town? Did you go back?
I went there, yeah, but there was nothing left, not even a monument, not even a gravesite. I didn't even know where my brother was buried.
Mm-hmm.
And they were so bad. They were killing the Jews after the war. When somebody came in, he came into Sosnowiec, my husband, and so-called a caretaker,
mm-hmm.
but were close with them, says to them, everybody's dead, and you're still alive?
Mm-hmm.
Mind you, after the war, that's our friends. So-called friends.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Did you go back to your home?
Częstochowa?
Yeah.
Yeah, I went there.
To the house?
They didn't find nothing. Nothing.
Was there anyone else living in your house?
Right. Some old Polish woman there, I don't even know.
Mm-hmm.
I went all over. I was in Auschwitz too with him.
Mm-hmm.
When it says Arbeit macht frei, I was there. But there was not a city in Poland, I wasn't there.
Mm-hmm.
From one corner to the other. Because you see, after the war, we didn't have to pay nothing.
Mm-hmm.
All you have to have is a little thing that you're going to look for your family.
Mm-hmm.
You're looking for people. And then everything
mm-hmm.
was free to you, buses or trains, everything. There were
mm-hmm.
no planes. We were going day and night. I was already tired. I was so tired out from that business. And I went back to Germany and I finally settled down.
Mm-hmm.
We got married. And I was there from we were there, what, about 8 months, and then we went to the American zone.
Mm-hmm.
Then I was living in a village. Ellen was born. We were there for 5 years, 45 to 49, 4 years.
What was the name of it?
In the village?
Yeah.
Stoffen, by Landsberg.
Okay.
Not far from Landsberg. It was about 6 kilometers.
Mm-hmm.
To take a bike and pedal every second day to my brothers. They were living in the barracks. I didn't want to live in the barracks.
Mm-hmm.
I had enough. And I came back and there was no place in the city. So I went out to the American embassy and I said to him, I says, I'm certainly not going to live in that barracks. I got enough ideas, barracks. He says, Mrs. Kislinski, there's nothing I can do.
Mm-hmm.
He said, there is no place. You want to go in a village? I says, I don't care where I go, but don't send me in the barracks. So I went to the village.
Mm-hmm.
They were real nice, you know, after the camp, they were real nice. He was playing football, I was playing handball with the girls, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But they were furious, the kids, the poor kids. I had an interview, I was speaking in the Vane University.
Mm-hmm.
When we were there, 50 people.
Uh-huh.
They asked me questions too.
Mm-hmm.
So I told them about this incident. When we came into the village in 1945, the little kids, the Jews coming, the Jews coming, the Jews coming. They were frantic, they were scared to death. You know, we were there for 5 years with him,
mm-hmm.
4 years. One day I came in, and a little girl about 5 years old
mm-hmm.
came in and sat down. We were a little bit younger, you know, we got acquainted. We were sitting down on my lap, and she goes like this.
Rubbing your head.
Yeah. And I says to her, Kitty, darling, what are you looking for?
Uh-huh.
But the mother told me. She says, you know what they said to the little kids? That all the Jews have horn. She was looking for me for horn. Then she says to the mother, Mommy, look it, in German, and I could speak fluently.
Mm-hmm.
Mommy, look it, Mrs. Fischinski, such a beautiful lady. Look at her, she's so nice, a young one. She has no horn, Mommy. And that kid adored me. When we went away from Germany in 1949,
mm-hmm.
they were all staying and crying like that. And even the big shots there from the whole town, mm-hmm. what you call it, the Burgermeister,
mm-hmm.
he said to my husband, Mr. Fischlinski, you're going away already to America. Tell us the truth. Are you really Jewish? Mind you, being with them 4 years. And I told this to the students, and they liked it.
Mm-hmm.
And they, yeah, mm-hmm. I had a number with my broken English. They picked me to speak for them.
Mm-hmm.
They asked me questions, I answered mm-hmm. them, you know,
mm-hmm.
to the best of my ability. But I will never forget that incident. Honey, I felt so rotten. I said, why did the poor little children running away from me? What did I do to them?
Yeah.
You see, they were put in such a, what you have, how do you express yourself in English?
Some
a hate that every Jew has horn. Remember that?
Yeah.
And the girl sat on my left and she touched my forehead.
How did the adult Germans treat you when you were living
there? Beautiful,
really?
Beautiful. Even the priest, if they made a party, they didn't start nothing until the Mrs. Fischlinski wasn't there.
Mm.
That's the way they treat me.
Mm.
Everybody. Used to go every Saturday, the bakery made a cake for me in a holly,
mm-hmm.
you know, and then they came and visit me and I had to come to them and we ate together and we mm-hmm. did everything. And we were only me, Benny and Ellen,
mm-hmm.
only three Jewish people in the village.
Did they ever talk to you about what they had done during the war?
No,
or?
Nobody knew nothing.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody knew nothing and nobody was responsible for anything. That's the nicest part about the bake from the baker. He was an SS,
oh.
and he was scared to death, you know.
Yeah.
And I said to him once, I said, I know you were an SS, but what I'm going to gain if I put you to jail or if I kill you?
Mm-hmm.
Will my people come back?
Yeah.
I told him that.
Mm-hmm.
I was outspoken. I didn't.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't fool around with them.
Mm-hmm.
But like I say, they were really nice. Really nice. When my Ellen is born, they didn't know what to do. Everybody brought something else. This one brought a layer, this one brought a bed, this one brought a bed. They didn't know what to do with me. And he was born in that village, 1946. My aunt speaks fluently German too. You know where he works? New York Times.
Uh-huh.
Works by the coffee auditorium there.
How did you decide to come to the United States? What made you decide to leave?
Well, I went to the Europe. My brother, Israel, remember, I didn't, because when they left, I was born in 1924. My auntie, the family, my mother's family, went to Brooklyn. No, Bronx, New York. And he knew the name, Schwartz. So what happened that I went over to the Euro and I put down in the forwards that we are looking for family and that we are so-and-so, and their names. You know, my mother was this name. And what about 4 or 6 weeks we got back a letter that we should tell them exactly our names and our ages and where we are born, and what was our mother's name and our father's name. And sure enough, they took my two brothers. They sent them an affidavit and he went to New York. I remained in this village with my husband and my son. Well, they weren't too rich or too that they could take all of us, so. This one here was a carpenter, and he wanted to go to Israel. He said, I don't want any more. No more here, the word Jew. I want to go to Israel. Whatever will be, will be. And I figured myself like that. If I go to Israel, I never see my brothers, probably once in 2 to 5 years, maybe 10 years. So at night, I took the blue, he had a green card, and I took a bicycle, and I went to Landsberg, and then I took a bus, and I went to Munich. I came into Munich and I start crying and I told them the story. I would like to go to America because all I had found after the war, we were 10 children, I found 2 brothers. And I don't care where I go as long as you send me to America. And I wouldn't say a word to him because he didn't want to go. About maybe a month, 6 weeks later, they're calling me to the order, Landsberg. He says, what the hell I have to do with him? I'm not going. I says, Benny, we have to go. They call us. So we went to Landsberg. Sure enough, I have an affidavit to Oklahoma City. I says, how far is Oklahoma from New York? He says, it's very far. I says, but it's America, isn't it? He says, oh yes, it's America. You're closer to Texas and California. It's nice there, no winter. I says, I don't care, but send me whatever you want. So, Jack went February, Israel went March, and I went November. Not with my family, but the joint told me, to Uro, to Oklahoma City. It's a beautiful country, no winter. You couldn't make a living. There was no carpenter work. He's a carpenter. The only work was to make is the ammunition factory. To work in the ammunition factory, you have to be a citizen. They won't let you in. You have to wait 5 years to be a citizen. So he was working by the, you know, the little basket where you go to the grocery, Humpty Dumpty. Very hard. Started at 6 o'clock in the afternoon, he came home 6 o'clock in the morning, and he slept all night. All day he slept. He was losing weight. I mean, it's no fun. I went over and I started talking to them. I said, listen, he came out from a concentration camp. The guy was 70 pounds. I says, he's not going to survive. So a couple of people went to Detroit, the motor city. But my husband decided he's going to go. I remained there with Ellen. He was good to me, too. They put me in a strictly gentle neighborhood. I couldn't talk a word English. We had fun. We had fun there, believe me. And he came here and he found a Hudson motor car. He was working a little bit and he brought me this Ellen. And I was living in 12th Street by a woman. He rented a room. It was very bad to get an apartment. I took Ellen by my hand. Who wants a kid that time? Nobody. So Schwarze got pity on me and she took me in on the third floor in Pingree. Never forget. The chimney was right there. I was that hot. We were almost naked, summer and winter. And we survived. For some reason we survived. We brought two more. Then he started working. He made an examination in March. And I started working by the carpenter. And I went to work. And we struggled.
How did you feel initially when you came to the United States?
I slept 3 months on the floor, believe it or not. 3 months. Didn't have a piece of furniture, nothing. I felt good. I figured maybe for now I'm going to be able to put my head up and say I'm Jewish.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Mm-hmm.
We don't deny, honey.
Mm-hmm.
When my husband first went for an interview, he happened to come into a Polak.
Mm-hmm.
You know how Polaks feel about Jews. Mm-hmm. I think the feeling got mutual.
Yeah.
So he said to him, it was summertime and my husband happened to have a number. He says, what is this? He says, this is a number from a concentration camp. I was in a concentration camp. He says, are you Jewish? He says, yes. He says, you're going to work for me. He says, because the Jews come in here. And I can smell they are Jewish, but they wouldn't tell you. They wouldn't say. They deny. Why? You were in a camp. You are struggling for a Jewish. Why are you have to shame?
Mm-hmm.
Be Jewish. He thought he's a German or an Italian, you know. Mm-hmm. He don't actually live Jewish.
Mm-hmm.
But we don't deny, honey.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Did you come across any anti-Semitism here?
Plenty. I was working in a market.
Yeah.
In a fruit and vegetable market in Warren, Illinois.
Uh-huh.
Remember? The market there, the big one?
You don't remember.
You don't remember. There's German coming there and Polacks coming there and everybody. So one Polish lady said to the other one, in Polish, she says, look at the Jews, I like the cat. You throw them out from the door, they're coming to the windows. They didn't have nothing. Hitler didn't kill them enough. And I was listening to this.
Mm-hmm.
Kira, I went over to her and I grabbed her here.
Mm-hmm.
And I said to her, but I told her the real nasty word. I don't want to say it because I'm here interview. A real nasty word. And I says, you get out of here. I says, I don't want to see your face anymore. And I happened to have a watermelon there with a knife. And I said, you see that knife? You come here once more and that knife going to be in you. Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't know you're Jewish too. I says, yes, I am. I was 5 years in a concentration camp. Are you going to tell me that?
Mm-hmm.
I says, yes, I'm proud, I'm Jewish. And she never came. My boss lady was mad because she happened to be a good customer. She left $10-$15 a Saturday, you know. She says, what did you do? The customer went away. I says, 10 other ones going to come back. You know what she said? I don't care, as long as you make the money. So you know what I did? I took the apron off my face and I said, you're going to see me like you.
Mm-hmm.
It's exactly what I told.
Mm-hmm.
I never went back. And I was working 16 years, was I?
Mm-hmm.
No, I am very upset when I hear that somebody...
Mm-hmm.
Who you think throw the Nazis out here when they open up the stores? Who was there picketing, me and him? In the Shara Saplaita. Who threw out Rockwell? You remember Rockwell was here a few years back. I went over to the Anti-Defamation League to Mr. What is his name? No, the other guy. He says, oh, Mrs. Fisk, he says, let him talk. He's not. I says, remember, I says, it started in 39 too. We let him talk.
Mm-hmm.
We let him talk, all right. Look what's happened.
Mm-hmm.
He says, you don't want to do nothing? You wait. He's not going to talk. Mr. Weatherman, Mr. Fisk, 10 other guys went there, and girls went there. He didn't talk.
Mm-hmm.
They had a few knives, they had a few pistols, and they said to the guy there, what he hold the Dracula there, he says, look, we don't care. We are coming out from a concentration camp.
Mm-hmm.
To us it doesn't matter. But if he's going to speak, his head is going to be down. You know what they did? They took him in a car and they... get him out. But not American. Don't be mad at me, sweetheart, that I'm telling you that. But not American show up. The new American, the refugee show up to disperse because there was people already standing and listening and wanted to hear what they have to say. You see? And the same thing was with the Nazi stores.
Mm-hmm.
Wherever was a store on Finkel, I was there.
Mm-hmm.
I was there. Every Sunday we went.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
When they put the swastikas on with the Jews, they figured what they're going to do with the Jews, with the colored people, you know, they made all fun of it and everything. We didn't go away.
Yeah.
We got to move. Now we have another rally, I understand, here in the 30th. You know about it?
No.
In the Civic Center.
Oh, yeah, I did.
Yeah, they're going to speak because they had to give them the privileges to speak. It's open, speech free. But I don't know. You're going to go. They open them out, they're going to get it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And was the exhibit the Israeli, remember?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
They didn't come out. They were there in the U-Haul, but they didn't come out. Mr. Einhorn went there, and he told the police, he said, bring him out.
Mm-hmm.
You're ready. Just bring him out. Let's hear what they have to say.
Yeah.
But they're not going to go back in the U-Haul. They're going to go back in a casket.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You have to stand up. How do you think that little Israel is existing?
Sure.
Poor thing are spilling the blood there of the country. But at least they know that we can do something too.
Mm-hmm.
I wish that our ancestors would tell us, take guns and fight.
Mm-hmm.
Could never kill 6 million, honey. Never. Yeah. Never. There would be million kills from them too.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Do you ever talk about what happened to you when you first came here? Did people ever ask you questions about the camps or
about the concentration camp? Well, like I say, I was on the Dane University. They asked me questions.
Earlier when you first came here, came to this country.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah, sure. I always talk about it with my kids. My Ellen is going to make a book too. He's going to write a book. You were here last time when I showed you the book, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's going to write a book. And then I have another story. When I was there in 1945 in Poland, my brother and my sister-in-law had a little baby in 1942, which I was no have knowledge of it at all, because I was already in camp. In 1943, when they went to Schrodula, and they were making the Judenrein, there was a woman living upstairs. I happened to know her because this woman used to wash clothes for my sister-in-law. So they figured they're going to Auschwitz, and they gave away the little baby to her. She was a half year old. We didn't have no knowledge of nothing, but when my sister-in-law gave the kid away, for some reason she had a Polak, and that Polak was going to my brother, to Irving, and told him that they are going for Judenrein. She couldn't say what, but they went to Auschwitz, and she gave away the little baby. To whom? How? What? Nothing. After the war, in 1945, the woman was very poor. I understand she struggled a lot to raise Miriam. That was my niece, my brother's child. So she went to the Jewish community center and she put on a little, she had a Jewish kid and she named it by her Jewish name, Miriam Saramonji. Because she adopted, and her name was Miroslava Wonchkowska. She wouldn't keep the Jewish name.
Right.
My brother happened to be Orthodox, and he prays for the people like my father, Oliver Shalom. So the rabbi shaved his beard and went to Sosnowiec, and he went in at the Jewish community center, and he found this little hanging that little slip there, and he wrote down the name exactly. When he came back, he says, Mr. Monchik, how do you spell your name exactly? So he wrote it down. He says, Mr. Monchik, you have a kid in Sosnowiec. And she was already 16.
She was
16 years old. She's born in 1942. Now she's 40, 41.
Yeah.
Well, we start acquiring, okay? My two brothers didn't tell about nothing for me. So one day we took the rabbi, we sent him back to Poland. And he came into that Mrs. Lonchkowska and made a date with my niece. And when she went back from school, he waited for her. And he told her the whole story. Listen, kid, you're not Polish. You're born to Jewish people. Your name is Monchik. You got two uncles from your father. They live in New York. Mm-hmm. They're very wealthy. You have to put stories on, you know. And we want you to come back to New York because you're not going to have nothing here in Poland. But she used to tell me that when she went to school, they used to call her Jew. So she came home crying to her mother and she says, Mama, why they call me Jew? She says, because all the Jews are dark complected, they have black eyes, you know. And that's all. But when she find out that she's Jewish, she says for some reason she had a different attitude, a different heart, a different feeling, you know.
Yeah.
So he told her the whole story. And then he says, now it's up to you. So she says, look, I'm going in my last 2 years gymnasium. When I finish my schooling, I'm going to decide what I want to do. Stay with the mother or go to America. Well, I'm just giving you briefly. Sure enough, she was 18 years old. We couldn't bring her here because it takes a while to make papers and to go to a doctor back in Munchik, you know.
Sure.
So I went to the lawyer and the lawyer gave me a good idea. He says, you know what? You bring her here continuously to go to school, you know. That she comes here as a student. And she can come in Miroslava Wojcikowska. My brother went twice, three times a week to Washington, D.C. to try to adopt her back on Munchik. She said that my brother's child, she belonged to me, she belonged to us. And that was going on and on. Finally, when she came, thank God, we adopted her. She lives in West Bloomfield. She has three beautiful children. I came to get her, and I brought her here. She met her husband. She had three lovely kids. Got two kids already in Ann Arbor. Got a daughter, 19, a son, 18, and a little girl, 17. And that's the story.
Did she ever see her?
Oh yeah, she goes back there very often. Oh yeah, that's her mother. There's no question about it because it wouldn't be for her. It wouldn't be it. Wouldn't be alive. She was a nice human being anyway because a lot of Poles take the money and take everything and they say to the German, here is a Jew. But she was a different human being, that's all. Happened to be an elderly lady. She goes back to see her. It's her mother.
Do you have any...
It's a double story, huh?
Yeah.
I tell you. I have a long story.
Do you have any physical illnesses now as a result of these?
Oh my God, do I have. 17 years ago I had a mastectomy. This is not mine. I developed a sugar. My husband has to give me shots because I can't have a sugar diabetes. Last year the sugar was so bad that I had to have two lasers in my eye. This one is very blurry. I mean, now thank God they cut. You know, so sure I have plenty. It's on the desk. Top of it, I had a very high blood pressure, but it's under control now.
Is any of that, do you think, related to the experiences
during the war? Sure. Don't forget, you don't need 5 years. They're undernourished. They're under everything. You know, the things come back, nervous all the time, you know, any little thing irritates me. I mean, not the same person. When you're young and your nerves are going with you, when you get older and... Sure.
Do you ever have nightmares after?
The beginning, every night, he used to shake me every night, nothing came. I said, where am I? I have to get up. I have to get up. Jewish, you wouldn't know they're going to come in, she's going to kill me. I have to get up. He says, no, you don't have to, you're not a kid now. That was going on for a year, and I was married. And I was afraid to go to sleep.
Did you have any trouble before you came to this country getting papers to come to the United States? How did the officials treat you that were in Europe, the United States officials?
No, I actually didn't have no trouble. I went over to, like I told you, to Munich, and I write for the papers, and she told me that I can go to Oklahoma City, that the Jewish Welfare Federation wants me. I said, I don't care as long as America. And then I was there about 3 months. I took my Allen, and I went to see my brothers. 3 nights and 3 days, I was on the bus. She wanted to help the newcomers, you know, with the speech. You know that we don't speak English, you know. She was a jewel of a lady. I remember she gave me a slip of paper, and it says that, please help this lady with a child. She does not speak English. She's a newcomer. She wants to go visit her brothers in New York. So one bus driver gave this to the other one, you know, and they used to take Ellen at night and changing the buses and stuff. I was only 3 years old, I was a baby. And believe it or not, the 18 bus driver brought me into New York. Yeah. But I went, even with not knowing my English.
Yeah.
I got by.
Yeah.
When you have to, you have to.
Do things ever happen today, or do you ever see things today that remind you of your war experiences?
Well, the only thing I'm frightened me is, you know, we brought a new generation, kids, you know, and God forbid what's going on here, even America, you know, I mean, it's ridiculous, you know, that you should live through again this. It's God forbid, you know, I mean, it's enough we went through. We don't want our children to go through this. I don't think that people will be able to survive what we survived. I don't know till this day where we take the courage and where we took the strength to pass through something like that, you know? It's even I went through myself, like I told you before, but it's unbelievable, even to me. I would like to see this, no. That's why I chose the United States, because I could have gone any place I wanted to go after the camp. I figured for once maybe I'm going to be lucky in, as a Jew to be counted. But let's hope. One thing I can tell you, they won't put us no more in a concentration camp. Because like our Bible says, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. That's what we learn. That's what God bless our Israel. That's what they have to do. They struggle for surviving. You see? Till this day, I can't believe it that we let ourselves like sheep for walking miles and miles and miles, and the chimneys were burning days and days and days and night. They were burning with our people, innocent people, children. I tell you another incident. In 1940, when we were going from Auschwitz to Sosnowiec, they were making Judenrein, that means without Jews. Gestapo came in to my cousin. She had a tiny baby in her hand. Has to be about maybe 2 months. And he says, fast, 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 you know. She tried to bundle the baby, took, he grabbed the baby, threw it on the wall, and the whole inside came out. And then she says to him, kill me too, please kill me. So he grabbed her here by her neck and he threw her out. He did not kill her. Kill the baby.
But again, I got a piece left over, but the left is working. I got a piece left over, yeah.
This was where?
This was in my mind for years and years and years. I could see that little baby. I don't think the baby was more than maybe 2 months old.
This was your cousin?
Yeah. She tried to bundle up, you know, to go take it out.
Yeah.
So sadistic.
Yeah.
You know? It's not It's a human being without blood, mm-hmm. without nothing. Mm-hmm. A little baby. I can see the whole mask, everything coming out in my eyes. You know how much I went through more, this little baby, than I went through with my own mm-hmm. experience. I told this to the student in Lane University. Mm-hmm.
And this was where? Where did this happen?
In 1940, yeah, in Auschwitz, when I was going to Sosnowiec.
Did any of the Polish neighbors that you had ever try and help you?
They were not Polish anymore. They say they're Volksdeutsch. They have Deutsch. They were not Polacks anymore. We were living in Phoenix City, like I told you mm-hmm. when I came for the wedding. And upstairs was a Polak. Mm-hmm. And he says to our neighbor, to Miriam's grandfather, mm-hmm. and grandfather was living downstairs, "We love you. You are our Jews. No, don't worry. Whatever happened, you're going to be right here." Mm-hmm. "Honey, no more." Hitler walked in the morning. He came over and he says, "No Polish." He spoke German. He says, "Leave everything and go before Hitler comes in here." "Yeah, don't take not even a stick of clothes, nothing. Just go." That's hateful, you call them, hateful mm-hmm. to the Jewish people. So how can we have a heart to them? Like I told you before, if it wouldn't be for them, honey, all right, they would kill maybe 2 million, million, mm-hmm. but never 6 million, never. Because a Polish person could smell a Jew 100 miles away. And he would say to him, "Oh, here's a Jew. Mm-hmm. That's a Jew." Would I have a heart to go back? No, my niece says to me, "Auntie, maybe you want to go with me to Poland." Mm-hmm. I says, "Miriam, I couldn't step in that land. I couldn't step on that ground where it's full of blood. Mm-hmm. That is Jewish blood, wherever you go. Name me one concentration camp except Poland. Treblinka, Majdan, Buchenwald, Auschwitz. You know why? They wanted to get rid of the Jews. You know what's happened in Denmark when they say they're going to prosecute the Jews? You put on a Star of David and he says, "Take us. Take us all. You don't have no Jews. We are all. Take us." You see? There is human beings yet in the world, but they are not human beings. Mind you, after coming back, a guy like this, like my husband, he was weighing 70 pounds from the Russian. A year, I had to bandage his leg, he couldn't walk. And the caretaker says to him, "Everybody's dead and you're still alive? Can you believe this? And this is so-called our friends?" That's why, if I hear there's something going wrong in Poland, mm-hmm. they have no food or something, I don't feel pity for them. Mm-hmm. Who helped us? Did anybody came and say, "The sisters and brothers are burning there, let's help them, let's go and do something for them"? Anybody? Mm-hmm. Why should I feel sorry for them? If we are miserable, and if we are not nice, or if we are not generous, this is not our fault.
Did you read the book, Sophia?
I wanted to be in there. Yeah. Not a nice thing. She might go there and listen to them, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah. What else, honey?
Well, is there anything else you'd like to say about your experiences? Any other?
Thank God I'm fortunate. I got 3 nice children, good children. They're with me constantly. I have my daughter, God bless her. She's a jewel. Mm-hmm. As soon as she don't work a day, she's with mommy. Calls me in the morning, comes over, we shop, we go over place together. Mm-hmm. It's like girlfriends, not like a mother mm-hmm. and a daughter. Mm-hmm. My older boy, she's too good too. He mm-hmm. calls me, my daughter-in-law, "Mommy, we love you, we love you." He wants to come back. Mm-hmm. Wants to make some money, come here and start. He was working for the Free Press, so they told mm-hmm. him that they want to give him back the job anytime. Mm-hmm. He can come back and have the Free Press back. and my husband. He was here yesterday. And like I say, I'm fortunate. Thank God, I have a good husband and good kids. That's the most important. My family, two brothers. We see you very often, you know, mm-hmm. with the Pesach I'm going there.
What do you wish for your children, for your grandchildren?
Not to go through that experience, mm-hmm. what we went through, that's for one thing. But they should have a peaceful life. Mm-hmm. I don't care if you have to struggle, everybody has to struggle. You know, mm-hmm. life is not a bowl of cherries, mm-hmm. you know. I came to this country, we were struggling terribly. I was sleeping 3 months on the floor. Mm-hmm. And I didn't want a penny from nobody. Whatever we have, it's all to our 20 mm-hmm. fingers. Yeah. And I'm proud of it, believe me. I never ask nobody for a penny. Mm-hmm. It's a matter of fact, when I can help, I help. Mm-hmm. It comes a Easter, or comes a New Year's, or comes something, I'm involved with organizations. I always call for people to help them, mm-hmm. you know. Mm-hmm. I like, that's my pride and joy too. Mm-hmm. I feel good when I can help somebody. Because I know how I was when I came here and the Jewish vocation helped me bring to the United States. Mm-hmm. I'm forever grateful. Mm-hmm. The only thing I like to, that we should live in peace.
Yeah. Yeah.
In America there are so many nations from all over the Europe, from all over the, and we can get along. Mm-hmm. You get along pretty good. If one wouldn't steer the other, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. there would be nothing.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. One starts talking about and steering, you know, and telling mm-hmm. them, this was, no, this is all the Jews of. Naturally, we have the minority, we are mm-hmm. in the middle. So I told this in the UN University mm-hmm. too. When things are good, then you're my friend. When things are bad, then you turn against me. I hope I express myself.
You do very well. How do you feel about your faith now, your religion after the war?
I'm Jewish and I won't deny it. Uh-huh. Even if I suffer and even if uh-huh. I get the worst, but I went through a lot for yeah. it and I'm proud of my heritage. I wish I would have more of my people.
Yeah.
Believe me. Each and every one of us. If the kids get married and have 10 children, mm-hmm. they could never replace what we lost. Yeah. Could never replace. They lost for the whole life.
Mm-hmm.
And I do hope that someday when we are gone, that they will remember us and they cherish our Jewishness, our heritage like mm-hmm. we do. I do hope so.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's worth it.
Mm-hmm.
It's worth it what you go through and it's worth it. And if you can survive, if you figure to yourself, Hitler is not here, mm-hmm. but I'm here, so I survive him. So I'm looks like I'm more important.
Okay. Well, thank you very much.
That's it?
Thank you.
Well, you made a test with me. You know, big one.
Yeah.
When she passed away, all 10 children made themselves rings from it, you know, from the chain.
Uh-huh.
And, my father, I remember, had a gold watch. I don't know what's happened to that, you know, because
mm-hmm.
everybody in Europe had gold.
Mm-hmm.
And I do not know till this day what's happened, because I never even see him dying or anything.
Mm-hmm.
But we knew that we were sitting shiver. That's something I feel good about too, even if they don't have no grave. You know,
mm-hmm.
they turn the graves around and they take potatoes out. Can you believe it? To eat potatoes from a dead person? Well, the soul is good because it's all fat there from mm-hmm. human bodies, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But one thing I can understand, I was living in Germany before the war. Mm-hmm. I was speaking German too. They're supposed to be the most cultural, the most knowledgeable, the most finest people. Now, what happened that they could turn around like that, that one, like you say, one painter, he was a painter, Hitler, could do this to a folk, to a German, you know, a
yes.
big nation like this, it's unbelievable. Because they are really the finest people, the cleanest people.
Mm-hmm.
I know, I've been living with them.
Mm-hmm.
So someday I really think about it, you know? Mm-hmm. I says, how can... But when I was up, just like when I came to the village in 1945, I used to have many discussions with, because I was living there. And I says, I don't believe it that you folks let yourself in like this. Mm-hmm. You could see what's happened. And that was not a war. Usually you have a war. You go against the people who fight with you, right? But this was not a war. This was just to get ready of human beings, that's all. Because he figured, first he gets the Jews, then he gets the Gentiles. Even the Polacks. You know how many people, German people, were in the concentration camp with my husband in Auschwitz, who don't believe in Hitler? Quite a few. And they were there from 1940, mind you, because they didn't want to go to his regime, to his preaching, you know. So I used to talk to them, and I used to tell them, I used to say, how can you people be so, why didn't you open your eyes and see, you could see what's happened? Well, I understand that there was, the situation was bad, you know. They were really in dump. They didn't have what to eat, you know. And when you low down and you don't have what to eat, then you really turn one and the other. It's the truth. It's the truth. It's just the statistics says this too. You could never dream something like this could happen. Children? All right, mind you, big people, they could be mixed up in politics, stuff like that. But children? A million of million children to kill. I mean, it's unbelievable. You ever come to the to our what we have that memorial center, the center? I mean, every April we have a Yeskel.
Yes, sure.
Have you ever attended?
Yes.
I've been there. I stay by the door. Probably see me. Yeah, you probably see me. Well, I'll tell you something. To us, it's holy. We do what we can. We cherish and we share with people and we try to not to forget. We always wake up again and again and we tell the people what we went through, that they shouldn't go through this, to stand up and stand up for the rights, you know. So we try really to keep our heritage as holy as we can. But then it's up to the next generation if they will do it. I hope so, because that Holocaust, what you build now, you know, the memorial center, and all the stuff was in it, I mean, it's not a lie. See? If you talk people where they're gone, and then you take literature from them, and then you put down a book or something, it's different. But here you have living proof.
Right.
You know, you got people what went through on their own body. So we shouldn't keep quiet for one thing, you know, we should put our heads down, like in Europe, you know, when somebody was gone, we were afraid, we put our heads down. There was no reason for it. If we knew, if we had the knowledge then, what we have now, it would be much different, I can tell you that. That's why we try to teach our children too.
You've talked to your children about what happened.
Oh, yeah. They know everything from top to the bottom. Yeah. She sometimes, my daughter even say, Mother, how much can you repeat and repeat? I says, forever, Judy. Judy, forever. That thing should not...
Yeah.
Once we are gone, I want you to forget. I want you to teach and I want you to tell.
Mm-hmm.
We were 50 people in Divine University. We were telling stories from kids. They were from Mumford School. They were from other school.
Mm-hmm.
They, it's remarkable the question they put to you, you know? It's painful to talk, yes, it is. Some people can take it. They're fainting, they're getting very emotional, they're crying, you know? I'm having to hold myself. I'm not crying. Nothing to cry about. Won't help me to get emotional. To do, take another tranquilizer or a high blood pressure pill, you know? But I really enjoyed it, and I'm going to do it again. They tell me that they're going to call me. They are planning to speak in the Marigold College here.
Oh.
The nuns are very nice, very polite. I like them very much.
Good.
liked him very much.
I think that would help a lot.
If you close this, I'm going to tell you something.
How do you feel about the way the American Jews responded during World War II?
Well, I'll be honest with you. I don't feel good. Not at all. Because you, American people, should have gone twice a week to Washington, D.C. to put out petitions and say they're burning our sisters and brothers. Let's burn some German here. And let's see how it feels. Maybe they would stop it. Maybe the German in Europe would think twice what they're doing and they would stop it somehow. But I am sorry to say, American people here didn't have time for this because they were too busy making money. And to all due respect to the American, I love him. Mm-hmm. They brought me to this country and I love this country. Mm-hmm. And I wouldn't change for anyone. But I have to say the truth. I don't feel good about it at all, no. Not at all. Because they could do a little bit something about it, you know. At least maybe they could save us, a few of us. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But no, they were too busy and nobody knew about it. They figure, what's the difference to me? I'm in America. I have what to eat. I have what to drink. What do I care what's happened to them over there? Mm-hmm. And that's the way I feel now, too, about the Polish people. I'll tell you the truth. I don't care what's happened to them. They didn't care what's happened to me. Mm-hmm. Not one Polak came to give me a piece of bread when I was in concentration camp.
When it comes to Jews, nobody cares.
No? Why should I feel sorry for them? They feel sorry for me.
After all, we killed Jesus. We killed a Jew.
Yeah. I'm truthful. I mean it. I'm honest now with you.
Okay.
That's what I told Mrs. Weiner, the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
She really made me angry,
mm-hmm.
asking me question to forget. Why should we forget? We shouldn't forget and we shouldn't forgive. Never. As long as one of us is alive.
Mm-hmm.
One survivor from the Nazis is alive. We should not forget and we should not forgive.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. They're going to say that I'm nested.
No, thank you.